Good morning, church family. Let's take some time this morning to sing together. Let's lift Jesus up for who he is and what he's done for us. And just also remind ourselves that we can't do it by ourselves, can we? It's only his blood. It's only his blood that can wash away our sins. Let's sing together.
Oh, precious is the flow that
kiddos.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas shining as the sun, we've countless days to sing God's praise. Then when we first began, I once was lost, but now
please join me with your eyes closed, please. Dear kind Heavenly Father, Holy Son, and Holy Spirit, we love you and adore you, and we thank you for your mercy and for your love for us, and for being a God that we can depend on, for being an awesome God of creation and establishing this holy day for our benefit to learn to love you more. Lord, we pray for those who are ill today. We pray for your holy will to be done the same as it is in heaven. Bless them, help them to feel your presence. Lord, we know that you have mercy and goodness for all. Lord, we pray for our world that you so masterfully created. It's in a turmoil, Lord, beyond understanding. And we know that at the end of time, that will happen. And it seems unfathomable that it's happening now in our lifetime. So Lord, bless us, and thank you for showing us a way to help our fellow man, and to, as we put one foot in front of the other, you guide and direct us with your Holy Spirit to share our love, your love, with others, that love that can only come from you. Lord, we pray for our state and our president, that everyone will make decisions that will be good and honorable and bring honor to you and to praise your name, and continue to bless others with your word. We pray for our church, Lord. Even though we're separated, Lord, we are in unity. We want to be together, and we want to serve you in your power and your strength, and we thank you for that. We thank you for guiding us and directing us, and for each one in our church, and for all those that you have designed that will come in our presence. Help us to be charitable to all who come, and help us to lift them up to you and to bring them closer to you. We pray, Lord, for our families. Each of us has someone we love that is not walking with you. Lord, we thank you that you have your arms around them and you are trying to encourage them to love you more. And Lord, we know that we can depend on you to do that, and that you will not let us go until we have made all of our choices. So Lord, thank you for sticking closer to us than a brother, and for dying on the cross for us. We pray for forgiveness, Lord. You have promised that though our sins be of scarlet, they shall be white as snow. And Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for your sacrifice that made that happen. And Lord, please give us the power to sacrifice so that you can come soon. We thank you that you are lifting us up, that as we put one foot in front of the other, you will give us the strength to do what needs done. We pray, the Lord, that we will surrender our all to you in these last days, that everything we have, everything we do, and everything we say is in your power, in your glory, and will take us to your holy kingdom when you come to take us home to heaven. And we praise your name for that forever and ever. Amen.
Boys and girls, it's me, and with me comes many problems, and with problems I have Jesus who can help me. So let's say that I want some candy really bad, so I go to the store and I put it in my pocket and I think, oh, I probably shouldn't be doing that. I say, Jesus, help me not to steal. So Jesus comes into my head, and he doesn't allow that thought to still to come into my head. And then I have another problem. I want to do really good on a test, so I look over and I'm thinking I should look and cheat. But remember that Jesus is not to cheat. So I said, Jesus, help me not to cheat. And Jesus says, I will help you. And so he helps me not cheat. And then my mommy asked me to do something, and I'm like, I don't want to do that. And I thought, oh no, that means I'll be disobeying my mommy. I don't want to disobey my mommy. Jesus, help me not to disobey my mommy. And Jesus says, sure, I'll help you not disobey your mommy. And so that thought doesn't come into my head. And you know, I have more thoughts. And every time I have more thoughts, Jesus says, sure, I'll help you take that bad thought out of your head. And so what happens when we decide, oh, can do it on our own. We don't need Jesus. We just do it on our own. Oh no. But you know what? If you ask Jesus for forgiveness, he can make us brand new again. Yes, that is exciting. Happy Sabbath. Thank you for listening.
Good morning, everybody. I hope you are all well. I sure miss everybody, and I can't wait to be able to connect in a couple of weeks. I hope all things go well for that to happen. But I just hope and pray that everybody is doing well wherever you may be, and that today you are seeking and finding a blessing from God. This week we all perhaps watched the news, and we saw a couple of things. One being the launch of SpaceX Dragon, the first privatized space launch that was launched into orbit. And of course, the astronauts on board and the Dragon spacecraft connected with the International Space Station. Space travel has officially been privatized now. It's really just an amazing thing. It's an unprecedented time that we're living in. And perhaps you saw how the rockets landed then on top of a ship rather than fall into the ocean. Now, I saw a post on social media about this recently that was worth just kind of a chuckle. Somebody was commenting about the astronauts taking off into space, and they said, you know, maybe in light of everything that's going on in the world right now, leaving the Earth is a good idea. Now that's funny, you know, it's funny to think of, and of course there's a lot going on in this world. But it makes me think of faith. It makes me think of the gospel, and sometimes we talk about the gospel in an interesting way, as though it's some sort of spiritual fire insurance protecting us from hellfire in the end, or a means of escapism from the world. But I have to wonder, is that what Jesus really wanted for us? I also think of one of our favorite hymns, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. We all love that hymn. And think of the chorus, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, look full in his wondrous face, and the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. How nice it is to have a God that can make the struggles of this world fade away in the present. But what if those who deal with struggle and hardship and relational strain and oppression and abuse, what if they're struggling and that's just not good enough? What of these people? Is the gospel that we believe in just a matter of psychological escapism? Is it just pie in the sky by and by, as the saying goes? Or is it meant to be something more than that? I believe that the gospel not only gives us hope for the future, but strength and comfort in the present, as we realize that God came down to join us here in our struggles and pain. Jesus left heaven to descend to where we are to connect with us. Now, this world is full of people. We're all together on this planet, spinning through space, orbiting the sun. And I saw a quote from one of the astronauts actually this week that was on the that is on the SpaceX Dragon. Astronaut Bob Behnken, I'm not sure if that's how you pronounce it, but he says, there are no boundaries or borders really observable from space. You see that it's a single planet with a shared atmosphere. It's our shared place in the universe. I think that perspective, as we go through things like the pandemic, or we see the challenges across our nation or across the world, we recognize that we all face them together. We all face the challenges of this world together. Let that sink in. We all face them together. together. Now, we can, of course, in our faith, in the comfort of our own home, whatever it may be, we can plug our ears, we can hide our eyes, we can remain indifferent. But in doing so, are we really carrying out the mission of Jesus? Are we really living out the gospel that we cherish and love? Now, I've struggled this week. I've struggled this week a lot because I'm greatly concerned about the issue of empathy in the body of Christ. And it makes me think maybe we have forgotten the gospel. Now, there's a slogan that we have heard over and over throughout the past few weeks. It's a slogan that's now the name of a plaza in Washington, D.C., and this statement may make some of you happy and make you nod in agreement, and this statement may make some of you angry and want to just turn off this sermon right away, but I want you to think about why. And the statement is, Black Lives Matter. How does that statement make you feel? And I'm asking this question because I'm pretty sure I know who my audience is, both in my local church family and the guests tuning in right now. How does the statement Black Lives Matter make you feel? I want to just confess to you that I'm coming at you this week with a really heavy heart. Because as I've said, I'm really concerned about the church body, the body of Christ, as I see how people are responding to the protests and the cry, the heart cry of Black people in the United States. Now, of course, there are terrible things going on that are clouding out really the heart of the protests that are going on right now. We have rioting going on as well as protests, but we've got to make sure that we don't confuse the two, that the two aren't one and the same, because I've seen videos, for example, of rioters trying to loot buildings, trying to destroy cities, and protesters intervening, driving rioters out, taking their weapons of destruction away. I've seen protesters stand in the way of businesses while rioters are trying to destroy them, saying, no, this is not what we're here for. This is not what we're standing up for. Now, terrible things have also happened in connection with these riots. We have of course, seen... We've seen people, black and white and all shades alike, be harmed, be assaulted, be murdered by rioters. Terrible, terrible, awful things happening in this world. And the issues get so convoluted that we miss the message of the protest because of the violence that's erupting, where people give into their human nature, take advantage of a situation, and cloud what's really going on. I'm saddened to see terrible, terrible things also happening where a video was released this week of a police force walking through a town and a elderly white gentleman is standing there. And they just plow right through him. They shove him. The video is very clear. They shove him and he splits his head open on the pavement and is bleeding out while the police walk by. These are terrible injustices, terrible things that are happening in this world. And I'm sorry for sharing those graphic details if they're causing you to squirm, but the protests that are coming out are in response to systematic injustices that are keeping people of color from experiencing freedoms and privileges that that white folks experience every day. Now, the way that we view the world, our lens, and if you're still with me, the way that we view the world impacts everything. It impacts how we respond to the world. And the lens that I'm coming from is that I am a white, middle-class male. I'm young, and there's many things that I have experienced in my life that people of color don't have the privilege of experiencing. And there are many experiences that people of color have experienced that I've never experienced. I don't know what it's like to be assumed to be a criminal when I walk into a store. I don't know what it's like to be profiled. I don't know what it's like to be followed around when I go shopping as though I'm about to steal something. I don't know what it's like to fear for the lives of my children because of their skin color. And I don't know what it's like to fear for them because their skin color is going to mean that they will be criminalized and profiled. This is stuff that's happening in our world. And this is stuff that people of color experience on a regular basis. And if you don't believe that's true, then I would just encourage you to ask someone. Ask a person of color. Get to know them. If you don't know anybody, and hear, listen to their story. Now, I don't know what it's like to have to be told by my father's son, when you go out into this world and if you get pulled over by the police, cooperate with them, even if they're doing things that are against your rights. Just cooperate and keep a good demeanor and don't resist because it could mean your life. Now, let me go on a tangent here. I'm not at all saying that the police are bad. In fact, I had to correct that misconception just this week, just yesterday. I'm not saying that, and people aren't saying that. There are bad people who do bad things, regardless of their title. And what's being protested right now is systematic injustice toward Black people and abuse of power that was triggered by the police officer kneeling on the neck of George Floyd and extinguishing his life. I don't know what it's like to have to fight uphill to make a living because of systematic injustice. And I'm saying all these things, and I realize that the cost of saying these things as a pastor, as a leader. But I say these things because I believe that enough is enough. And you may think that by me saying these things, it automatically means that I'm a leftist, an extremist. And I'm saddened if that's what you believe about me. And I want to get off this subject right away because this is not about me. I just want to challenge you, church, to not let your political party, your politic, shape you. But I want to just plead with you to let the gospel shape you. Let the gospel be the lens through which you see this world. I have a few things to say about that. I want to try to make it as quick as possible, but social justice has to do with working for societal change so that there is equality of privilege. And many people have said that these are not important things to be talking about. Pastors shouldn't be talking about this. The church shouldn't be talking about this. We have more important things to be talking about. I'm convinced that issues of justice are just as important as the other 28 fundamental beliefs that we believe in our church. We need to be talking about these things. We need to have the courage to talk about these things. But let me just switch gears here as we talk about now the gospel. Sometimes I hear people say that social justice is the gospel. Well, I understand where people are coming from, but if we're consistent with Scripture, this actually isn't true. Social justice is not the gospel. Now, I may be losing some other people now at this point, but hear me out, please. Social goths, so, excuse me. Social justice is not the gospel. It is the fruit of the gospel. That is the distinction. It seems like people on the left or on the right in the church tend to fall into some ditches. And the left tends to fall into the ditch of feeling like social justice is the means by which salvation is earned. And people on the right tend to slip into the ditch where performance and strict obedience and keeping the rules are those things that earn you salvation. But neither of those things are the gospel. Those are ditches that we can fall into. The gospel is clear in the Bible. The gospel, what is the gospel? The gospel, in sum, is the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, full stop. I'm going to say it again. The gospel is the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, full stop. That's the gospel. That's it. Now, we find this really clearly in some words from Paul to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 15, 1-5. He says, "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, in which you received, in which you stand, by which you're being saved, if you hold fast the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. In other words, the gospel, Paul is saying, is the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And each story in the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, is called a gospel. That's because it is the good news about the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Let's consider his life for a moment. Jesus' life was all about a message and a ministry. It was about a message and a ministry. And the message was the message of God's love and plan to liberate humanity from their sin through the ministry of the Son of Man, through him going to the cross. Jesus said that we needed to repent because the kingdom of God was at hand, and he also said that the Son of Man came to suffer at the hands of man and die, and on the third day be raised again. This is the gospel. This is the gospel message, and the ministry of Jesus had to do with bringing love and hope and healing and compassion to others. This was the gospel being brought into practical life. Jesus came into this world and he had a particular purpose. Stay with me now, please. We read this purpose in Luke chapter 4, 16-19. And before I get into that, those of you who are on social media have seen my posts over the past week. Last week, it was interesting, on Sabbath, I had someone reach out to me and say that issues of racism and justice are not what we need to be focusing in on the Sabbath, that there are more important things to be talking about. And I didn't want to get into an argument with this individual, but it's interesting what we see Jesus do on the Sabbath. And let's look at Luke chapter 4, verses 16-19. It says that he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day. And he stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written. And listen to this. Listen to what Jesus says about what he's all about. He says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind." Listen closely. "To set at liberty those who are oppressed and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Now, of course, a lot of this has to do with the spiritual condition of the heart and the bondage that we are in sin, when we live carnal lives, self-centered lives. And those are the very things that blind us to compassion and empathy toward others. And Jesus says, "I have come to save, to proclaim liberty, to deliver people, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." He says he has a, message and a ministry. And then it goes on, it says that he rolled up the scroll, he gave it back to the attendant, and he sat down, and all of the eyes on the synagogue were fixed on him. If we read further in the story, it's interesting what happens. Now, Jesus is saying, this is what my life is all about. And when we look at these passages, we can't, or this passage that he preached, that he shared, and it comes from Isaiah. We can't cherry pick here and there. This is what his life was all about. It's a whole package. Jesus had a message and he had a ministry, but the responses of the people are telling. Much like the responses of people today, really. They either stood back in wonder and considered, wow, this is true. Jesus is the Messiah. They either responded with a positive response that changed the way that they saw things and changed the way that they lived, or they wanted to throw him off a cliff. They responded to Jesus' statement of his mission of justice and liberty by either accepting it or wanting to kill him and destroy him. Jesus then goes forward from this moment and he's ministering to people, he's healing people, he's taking care of people, he's delivering people from demons, and he's delivering people from sickness, but then he's also preaching and teaching. And one of the things that Jesus teaches is this story, it's a parable of the lost sheep, where this sheep leaves the fold of 100 total sheep and gets lost. So there's the one lost sheep and there's the 99, and the shepherd leaves the 99 and goes after that lost sheep. That lost sheep was helpless. It couldn't do anything about its condition. And the good shepherd leaves and goes and rescues that sheep. And that tells us that not only is Jesus concerned with all, but Jesus is concerned with the specific situation. If it were just you, or if it were just me who sinned and rebelled and became eternally lost, God would have still left heaven to come after us. That is the kind of love and mercy and compassion he has. And then Jesus also tells the story about a man who was beaten up by robbers, left for dead on the side of the road, and the priest and the Levite, the religious people who had better things to do, evidently, walked right by. Maybe they had to go and pray somewhere, I don't know. But they walked by this man, and this Samaritan came by and helped the man, wiped up his wounds, cleaned him up, took him to an inn, fed him, gave him water, took care of him, told the innkeeper, if there's any expenses for this man, I will come back and I will pay for it. Showing compassion and empathy. Jesus tells these parables as a part of his message, showing that his ministry and his message were all about compassion. Jesus had a message and he had a ministry. And it involved empathy toward the oppressed, toward those who are helpless to fix their situation. And then the amazing thing is, and here's where we get into the application for us, friends. It says that he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. The message and the ministry. Again, he tells his disciples to do this. And his disciples had seen the work of Jesus. They're with Jesus in his life. And they know what his priorities are. And then they go out and do it. And friends, we can't forget the gospel. We have to get into the gospel and study the life of Jesus. And that is the lens by which we interact with the challenges, the injustices, the struggles of this world. Consider this. We are called to do the very things that Jesus did in this world by message and by ministry. This week, I talked to my kids about racism. I told them about what it is, and they listened to me with wide eyes, and I broke it down to them to their level, and I talked about how people judge people or mistreat people based on the color of their skin. And Mariah, my oldest daughter, responds, She says, but why do people do that? They're just people. And then Judas says, I wish there were real life superheroes. And I told them a little bit about how we can listen and care and show compassion and empathy. And that's what being a superhero is all about, because our greatest superhero, Jesus, did those very things. There are superheroes, but not in the comic book sense. There are the first responders. There are police and paramedics. There are firefighters. But then there are those who have taken a stand to become allies of the oppressed. Think of the leaders of the civil rights movement. Think about the nonviolent protesting of Martin Luther King Jr. and what he stood for. But ultimately, think about the allies, the white people, the white allies who came to help the situation. To get blacks, people of color, equal rights, it wouldn't have happened without the white vote. Because those in a powerless situation cannot get themselves out of that situation. It was the same with women's suffrage, if we study our history. And Jesus, in his life, he shows us that empathy and compassion are a part of his mission and his message. And Jesus, of course, embodies that by ultimately going to the cross and dying for us. When we hear the words, Black Lives Matter, sometimes our immediate response, and I see this all the time, is, wait, all lives matter. And yes, of course, that's true. Anybody with a functioning brain knows that all lives matter. But there's a portion of our community on this planet that we are all on, that we're all in this together, that there's a portion of our community, our country, who are hurting, who are suffering, who are frustrated. And because compassion and love are Christian values, as an empathetic Christian, I want to come alongside them and say, yes, Black lives do matter. This is not about politics. This is about equality. This is not about setting a group of people above another. This is about equality. Now, some people disagree with this statement, Black Lives Matter, and that's anyone's prerogative to disagree. Do Black Lives Matter? And some people will say, yes, but there's no but. When it comes to the gospel, we know that Black lives do matter, because all lives do matter, and Jesus leaves the 99 to go to the one. Now, let me put it this way. Maybe this will remove the politicized nature of it. Black lives are of value. Black lives are valued. And maybe that will give us the opportunity to say, yes, they do. And if we answer Black Lives Matter with a but, then we're not saying that Black lives have intrinsic value. We can also say, oh, we're colorblind and all lives matter. And then we're saying that we're unwilling to recognize diversity and the challenges that people of color experience. I read an interesting take on this. It comes from a man, his name is Doug Williford. I'm not sure who he is, but it speaks to me here. It says, if my wife comes to me in obvious pain and says, do you love me? An answer of, I love everyone, would be truthful, but also hurtful and cruel in the moment. If a coworker comes to me upset and says, my father just died, and as a response, I say, everyone's parents die, that would be truthful, but hurtful and cruel in the moment. So when a friend speaks up and in a time of obvious pain and hurt, and says, Black Lives Matter, a response of all lives matter is truthful, but it is hurtful and cruel in the moment. If we say, no, all lives matter, it would be like interrupting Jesus during a Sermon on the Mount. Jesus says, blessed are the poor, And then we interrupt her and we say, no, 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 Jesus. Blessed are all people. Why is it that highlighting one issue is assumed that we are disparaging another? Are we not secure enough to be able to look at issue by issue and talk about one without disparaging another issue? Of course, all lives matter. And since they do, it's okay to say Black Lives Matter. Look at the issue, not through your politic, but through the lens of the gospel. Jesus went after everybody. Of course he did, but he also went after the individual. And that's why we can say Black Lives Matter, because all lives matter. And Jesus proved that by going to the cross for us, giving his life for us. Jesus goes to the cross. This is part of the gospel. This is his death. He has an unjust trial. He's accused of someone who stirs up the people. He's found not to be guilty. But then he was guilty in the eyes of the people because they didn't like him. They didn't like what he stood for. And then the people would rather let a felon free and condemn the innocent Jesus as a felon. Jesus was innocent. But then Pilate, as Luke 23:25 says, he delivers Jesus over to their will. And then Jesus is led to the cross. And it's interesting in that story how on the road to Golgotha, the place of the skull where the crucifixion happens, there's a man, Simon of Cyrene, and he's caught off guard because the Romans get him to carry the cross of Jesus. And Simon had nothing to do with Jesus' sentencing, nothing to gain by walking with him to Golgotha, I guess, except for obeying those Romans. But he had no obligation to join in his suffering, but Simon carried the cross of Jesus. He joined him in his suffering. I don't know about you, but I want to be a Simon. I want to have empathy in light of the gospel. Jesus is also, he's crucified. He's mistaken to be a criminal. And people would walk by the crucifixions and they would see these criminals on the crosses dying and they shake their heads at their guilt. They don't know their story. They just know, well, if they weren't a criminal, they wouldn't be dead. They wouldn't be on the cross. But here, the innocent Son of God is hanging on the cross like a criminal. The gospel is centered around the crucifixion. And Jesus goes to the cross, taking the place of both the victim and the victimizer. Jesus suffers with the victim, the victims of this world, those who go through terrible things. Isaiah 53 says that he has borne our griefs and sorrows, and by his wounds we are healed. That tells us that God suffers with those who are suffering. But then Jesus also suffers for the victimizer, the one causing the oppression and the suffering, as the substitute. Isaiah 53 also says, he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. There's justice at the cross. There's mercy at the cross. And we quote the most popular verse in the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. This is the lens through which we view the world. Now imagine all the hate and the aggression and darkness and sin absorbed by an innocent man on the cross. Imagine all of your anger, your hatred, mine, being met by a man dying for our liberation. Jesus dies on the cross, doing the very thing that he said that he would do. This is the gospel. And then Jesus is resurrected. And this changes everything, because this means that everything that Jesus taught and stood for is true. Who can be raised from the dead except for God? Jesus is resurrected, and this also tells us that life can be made new. We have hope for the future, but we also have new life now. And Jesus then sends his people out after being resurrected with a message and a ministry, and they do it They go out with boldness because they have confidence in the risen Christ. Now I want to read just one passage here, and then I want to show you a video, and then we'll close out. But this is an important consideration in light of the gospel. This is actually here where we get into the fruit of the gospel. We've seen the gospel, the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Here is the fruit. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Amen. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. There's the ministry, and it's of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. There's the message. Therefore, we are ambassadors of Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might be the righteousness of God. In other words, what the Bible is telling us is that when we are in Jesus, we're made new from the inside out, and then we go as ambassadors of Christ, doing and teaching and living the very same way Jesus did. And if Jesus was compassionate and empathetic, if Jesus was a servant, if Jesus stood for liberty of the oppressed, I want to be that way too. I want to live for him too. He had a message and a ministry. Way back in 1896, Mrs. White, Ellen White, she wrote this. She says, the American nation owes a debt of love. Now notice, it's a debt of love. The American nation owes a debt of love to the colored race, and God has ordained that they should make restitution for the wrong they have done them in the past. Those who have taken no active part in enforcing slavery upon the colored people are not relieved from the responsibility of making special efforts to remove, as far as possible, the sure result of their enslavement. Wow. Wow. Those of us who embrace the writings of Ellen White would do well to pause and reflect on that statement. This Wednesday, I helped facilitate a demonstration downtown. Another pastor and I called upon and joined many colleagues in ministry to go downtown Portland to Pioneer Courthouse Square in the midst of the protest and pray for the city, for the country, especially in response to the cries of the Black community. We went down there to show that the church cares. I want to show a little video about that moment with you, and then just tell you a bit more about it after we come back.
We are a people that believe in a God that liberates oppression. We believe that we have a God that is a God of justice. And so today, we have faith leaders here. We have people of faith that actually want to join and lend their voices to what is going on in our country right now.
And so as a Black African-American man, I just want to say thank you to each and every one of you, all of you here, for making that decision to stand up for what's true and what's right. 50 years from now, this is what you're going to remember.
Just thankful that each and every one of you can say truly that someone like me, that my life matters to you.
And so we're gathering here as faith leaders standing hand in hand to show our community that we do care.
All of us are leaders when we raise our voice.
Keep making decisions for right. Keep making decisions that Even though my family, my friends may tell me not to do this, but in my heart, I know what's right.
I have done a whole lot of learning over the last little while.
The posture of listening and caring about how other people feel, not rushing to defense, but rather rushing to understand.
There's something at stake by making a stand here.
We're lending our voice to the changes that need to take place.
None of us ever wanted to be here right now, because we didn't want what exists in our nation to exist today. We didn't want the loss of another precious life because we haven't learned our lessons as a nation.
And I want us to kneel for 8 minutes in honor of those who lost their lives.
Folks, can you imagine what that would have been like if you were lying face down with knees on your neck? That's why we're here, to talk about the injustices that still exist in this country. We pray that you will never forget the names of those individuals who have died because of those injustices and because of racism that still exists in this country. Remember the name of George Floyd. Don't forget his name, but that could have been any one of us. And so today we stand with those families who are grieving, with those who have lost their lives, calling for justice and equality and equity in this country.
Because in the end, God, we're your children, every one of us. We have a responsibility to our neighbors, to our communities, to our children, to not just walk looking out for ourselves, but to walk with an eye out for the other.
Almost at the end of this experience, there was a black man who came up to us, and nobody knew who he was. He wasn't a part of a church. In fact, he admitted that he had no church affiliation. And he took that megaphone that you saw in the video. We didn't know him, but nobody did, but we wanted to give him the platform to listen to his heart, because that's what the church should do. And he said this, and this just really stands out to me. He says, you know, black people die all the time. And we aren't surprised by that. Nobody is surprised by that. I'm quoting him here. But what we are surprised about is how many of you showed up on our behalf. People won't move, he says, until we have an intentional conversation about this. This man was amazed that people who didn't have to show up showed up. He also said this. He says, look at the people downtown that are tearing everything up. He's talking about the rioters. We don't appreciate that at all, he said. Again, look at the people downtown tearing everything up. We don't appreciate that at all. But then he says, as a fellow community member, I appreciate you from the bottom of my heart. Think of this. The church shows up to listen and show that we care and to pray, and it impacts a man who is surprised that we just showed up. And that's what Jesus has done for us. That's the gospel. And we live that out as the fruit of the gospel. And God showed up for us. The gospel is all about reconciliation. God's reconciliation to man, man's to God. And ultimately, the fruit of that is our reconciliation one to another. We are given the ministry of reconciliation. We are given the message of reconciliation. And the message is all about the gospel. And the ministry is all about living it. living God's good news, proclaiming it and healing it. And so for you and me, if we believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel now becomes the lens through which we view the world. It transcends politics. And when we look at the angry, frustrated, hurting cries of our Black brothers and sisters, we can join them in empathy because of the gospel. We can say that Black lives do matter. Let's pray. Oh Lord, God, on behalf of everyone listening, on behalf of your church, on behalf of myself, I just repent. We repent of our indifference, Lord, because we have forgotten the gospel. Lord God, please help us to be a people of empathy, of compassion, of engagement. Help us to show your love in a real and practical way. Help us to listen and care and not let our politics overshadow the gospel of your kingdom. But help us to be kingdom-minded. Lord, I just give thanks to you on behalf of all of us. Because you could have been indifferent to our helpless situation, but you left heaven and you came for us because you care, because you love, you so love the world. Lord, help us to have compassionate and loving hearts toward people of color, our brothers and sisters, and help us to embrace matters of justice as much as we do matters of prophecy, of the Sabbath, the state of the dead. May the fruit of your gospel be known in our lives and in our communities. In Jesus' name, amen.